Good morning, church family. Today's call to worship hymn is What a Friend We Have in Jesus, and it is hymn 499.
Almighty Father in heaven, wonderful Lord Jesus and blessed Spirit, it is amazing that we are here to worship the God of heaven, the Creator, the Sustainer, and yet, Lord, you are all those things and also our friend. How amazing that we can call you friend, Lord. May we praise you today. May we be connected to you today and commune with you again this day. As our God, our Savior, and our friend. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Congregation may be seated. Thank you for singing this morning. You sound great and you look great. It's a good day to be worshiping inside in Nebraska, in Lincoln. It's a wonderful day to look at the snow and, for me, stay inside and enjoy it from afar. But thank you so much for choosing Piedmont Park as your place of worship today. May you be blessed as we worship. Happy Sabbath.
Today's special offering is for religious liberty. Because of the snow and everything like that, we're postponing that religious liberty announcements and emphasis till next week. So we'll have more on that. Today we can be thankful for his blessings to us. We ask, Lord, now that the deacons will rise for prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the religious freedom that we have, that we can gather here and worship you in freedom and not have to be searched and attacked and all these kinds of things that people have suffered. Even now throughout the world, people suffer for their freedom of religion to worship you. We thank you for your goodness to us, and we ask, Lord, that you will bless the tithes and offerings and special emphasis today of religious liberty. We ask that you bless these funds. May they go to their intended purpose. In Jesus' name, amen.
White, I owe all to you. I owe to you, Jesus. Jesus. Savior of the world, Jesus.
As the boys and girls make their way back to the seats, I want to just help you with a few announcements today. Of course, you can read everything in your bulletin. There's a lot of stuff going on here at Piedmont Park, and we praise the Lord for that. But a few things that I just want to highlight today. We do have the tithe receipts for 2018, so if you would like those for tax purposes, they are at the welcome desk today. You can pick those up and use that if you would like. They're waiting there for you. Also, in a couple weeks, we have another Vespers program that's going to be happening here at Piedmont, a great way to bring in the Sabbath. It's going to be February 8th at 7 p.m., and you're going to be blessed to hear from Mick Ray. He's going to be talking about his work and mission work, and so it'll be a great time. So come out that night, February 8th, for a special Vespers service. And then the next day, there's going to be a bean auction. Now, if you don't know what a bean auction, it is a ton of fun. That's the day where beans become money, and you can use beans to get stuff. So you can read about it more in the bulletin. We'll talk about it some more, but that's a great day. You're going to enjoy it. That's a few weeks away. Next Sabbath, next Saturday night, we have another soup supper. Our soup supper time will be on February 2nd is the next one, and that's going to be a great time of food and fellowship. You'll enjoy that next Saturday night, so please come and join us. I believe that's at 6 o'clock, and we have a great time with that, so please come and be a part of it. And now I want to invite Pastor Ray to come up and tell us some good news, or some great news, maybe. What's it going to be today, Pastor Ray?
Well, Pastor, Renee has already told us that this is a day of celebration.
Yes, indeed.
And the boys and girls seem to understand what we're celebrating, the death and the burial and the resurrection of our Lord. But we're also here to celebrate something else. Mm-hmm. Not only did he pay our debt on the cross, but we have paid our debt on this building.
Amen. Amen.
And we want to celebrate that again today with a special report. And you'll need your bulletin, because I don't have any slides today to show you. You need your bulletin. And I want you to turn to the page that shows what our loans were originally consisted of. The original loan, as you see, was for $592,000. We were planning to pay that off in 20 years, and we paid it off in 3 years and 9 months. What do you say?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Pianist. And so that's something to celebrate, don't you think?
Yes, indeed.
Something to celebrate. But I want you to see also how much interest we saved by doing that. $141,592.29. Can you play another ditty? Amen. And then our final loan was $198,000. That was for 8.5 years. We paid it off in 1 year and 5 months. Here you go. Nick, would you keep her alert over here? And we saved $31,674.17 in interest. What do you say? And this is especially due to some large contributions that were made, and we are particularly thankful for that $33,000 contribution that we matched. And then this latest contribution that enabled us to remove the entire debt by the 1st of January. Now you need to look at the back page and see how much we owe back to our remodeling account. We have that remodeling account loan that we use to pay off the debt. We have $16,000 that we need to return to that fund. And the goal is to do that by the end of February. And Pastor, I think something else is coming up the end of February. Can you tell us about that?
That's right. On February 23rd, that's when we're going to have our celebration day. Coming up here in a few weeks, football is going to be going, Super Bowl is going to happen. Have you ever seen a football team not celebrate a victory? They just walk quietly off? No, they celebrate. As a church, we need to celebrate our victories with the Lord too. So on February 23rd, we're going to have a very special celebration Sabbath. We're going to have folks from the conference are going to be here that day, and we're just going to celebrate what God has done in our midst. Amen? So I hope you'll plan on being here. It'll be a special day, and we're going to just hopefully invite others to join us and talk about the good things that the Lord has done.
Just one more thing we need to mention about that day. That's going to be our next Bring Ben Sabbath.
That's true.
On the 23rd. And wouldn't it be good if by that day we could announce that we've returned that $16,000 to the remodeling fund? Mm-hmm. Let's try to do it by then. What do you say? Thank you.
Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Ray. Just one more announcement. I am excited about some folks who are making Piedmont Park their church family. We have some second readings to take care of today, some transfers in. We have Gaylene Bradley, who's coming from College View, Jade Koval, who's coming from Wanamaker Church down in Topeka, and Sherilyn Lagerman, who is coming from Beatrice, transferring in. And then we have a couple that is transferring to Allen Chapel. That's Ornan and Jamie. Do I have a motion to accept these folks in and out? I see a hand there. Is there a second? I'll take that as a second. And now, Jade, stand up here. Take a look. This is Jade, everybody. I saw her. I didn't see if Gaylene was here or if Sherilyn were there. Are you here? I didn't spot you earlier. If you are, wave at me. Throw something at me. Just make it soft if you're going to throw. Okay, I don't see them here, but Jade, you're here. So I want you to take a look. Everybody in favor of these transfers, let's see those hands. Anybody opposed? Jade, you are part of the Piedmont Park Church family. Welcome. Welcome. Thank you so much, everyone. And if you're looking for a church family, if you haven't found that spot yet, maybe you're here at Union College and you're not sure if this is right for you, keep coming. We would love for this to be your place of worship. And come and talk to me. We'd love to know more about you. So thank you so much for being here. Let's continue our praise and celebration of our Lord and Savior today. If you'd stand and sing with us our songs of worship.
Our song of worship today is Power in the Blood, hymn 294. And then all those who are able, please kneel in prayer with us. The prayer chorus is the refrain, Softly and Tenderly, hymn 287.
It's fine. So we kneel as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we hear you calling, and we are here this morning to answer that call. We are here to celebrate this wonderful Sabbath and to celebrate the sacrifice that you made for us so long ago. We knew for a long time that we've had a memory problem, and you must have known it too, Lord, that you would give us a weekly reminder of the creative power that you have. That we read in Genesis that you did create us, and in Exodus that you saved us, and that you reminded us that the Sabbath day was very important. Then you also knew that we might forget the sacrifice that you made for us, and so you gave us these emblems that we could remember that unbelievable sacrifice that you made. And then we also think of in Isaiah where you said that you would cleanse our lips, Lord, that we could be able to survive in the presence of a holy God. In Ezekiel, you said that you would do the miraculous of miraculous surgeries, that you would take a heart of stone out of us and give us a heart of flesh that we could love you. Lord, we claim all of these promises this morning, and we ask that you will work these miracles in us. And such an unbelievable sight that we studied this morning in the Sabbath school lesson about the throne room, and what a throng of people that will be. We want to be part of that throng, Lord, that we can sing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty," that we can sing, "Worthy is the Lamb," that so many things that we can enjoy in an earth made new with you, Lord. But until that time, there is much that we have to do. There are many people that still have not heard of you, and we ask that you will help us to find ways to reach people in our community for you, Lord. We also think of those that are feeling sick, that are dealing with illnesses and with diseases and with chronic issues. It is great to see that the list of names on the back of the bulletin is shorter than it has been, but we know that there are special needs listed here and also needs in our heart, Lord. And we just want to take a moment to pause and let the silent prayers of everyone here raise to you. We're so thankful that you hear us. No matter when we call to you, we can cry to you, we can call to you in praise, and you listen to us no matter what happens. We thank you so much for being our loving God, our wonderful Savior, and the presence that is with us always through the Holy Spirit. In Jesus we pray, amen.
Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper and laid aside his garments, took a towel, and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel which he was girded. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, "Lord, are you washing my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this."
Thank you very much, Samuel, for a beautiful reading of God's Word today. It's nice to have so many people involved, amen? Young and old, involved in worship. Every year I'm going to watch it. At Christmas time, I can't let a Christmas go by without watching this movie. My parents used to watch it when I was little, but I was too young to actually catch and understand the story. When I was little, I just wanted to focus on lightsabers and stuff like that. So I never understood it, but now I'm older and I love the story. So I have to watch this movie every Christmas season. I watched it last month with my parents again, enjoyed that. My kids watched it too, and they actually paid attention to the story. My favorite Christmas movie, It's a Wonderful Life. If you haven't watched it, I encourage you to, even though it is in black and white. In spite of its lack of color, it has an amazing story. There's one scene in the movie, the key moment in the life of the protagonist, George Bailey. He ends up at Mary's house, a young lady that he likes. And it's a pivotal moment in his life. Now, the young lady's mother, Mary's mother, is not happy that George is at their house visiting. So Mary's mom yells from the upstairs balcony, "Well, what does he want? Why is he here?" And George's answer, "I don't know. I was just out for a walk." Typical guy, right? Didn't know why he was there. George didn't know why he ended up at that house, or he didn't want to admit why he was there. He certainly didn't enter the house and say, "Mary, I have come to ask you out. I have come here because I'm in love with you." He couldn't say why he had come. What about you? What about you this morning? You, my friend, got up way too early on a Saturday morning. You did. And you came here to church. Do you know why? Could you offer an answer to that question? I have come to... Do you know? Well, Jesus knew that answer. He had his answer. He could fill in the blank. I have come to... Do we know why Jesus came? For friends, I believe if we know why Jesus came, then that will affect our answer for why we have come, or even for why we live. Do you follow me, friends? Jesus' answer should affect my answer. Amen? So why did Jesus come? Well, Jesus told people why he came. He didn't keep it a mystery. Luke chapter 19, verse 10, he said, "For the Son of Man," referring to himself as the Son of Man, "has come to seek and to save that which was lost." In Matthew 10, verse 45, it says, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve." So he told them. He told them why he had come. Simple, easy. Did the people get it? Did the disciples get it? No. Do we get it? Jesus had told people why he had come, but that wasn't enough. He had to show them why he had come. If you have your Bibles with you, I'd encourage you to open them to John chapter 13, to our scripture reading for today that Samuel did such a wonderful job reading. And here in John chapter 13, we find Jesus with only a few hours left with his disciples. He's taught these men for years. They have lived with him. They've traveled with him. He's told them why he had come to the world. Did they understand? Here on this fateful night, did they know and understand Jesus' mission? Not a bit. They're still planning on Jesus being some earthly king to rule Israel. They didn't get it. So you'll follow me in the story in John chapter 13, verse 3. It says, "Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, that he had come from God and was going to God." Verse 4, "He rose from supper, laid aside his garments, took a towel and girded himself. And after that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet." with only a few hours left with the disciples, with only precious few moments left to teach them, Jesus stands up to show them why he had come. For none of those men, not one of the 12, was willing to stand up and to take on the task of washing feet. See, that was the job of a servant, of a slave. None of them were willing to lower themselves to that level. So Jesus stands up to lower himself yet again, and he washes their feet. Did they understand what he was doing? Let's look and see. Verse 6. Then Jesus came to Simon Peter, and Peter said to him, "Lord, are you washing my feet?" And Jesus answers and says, "What I am doing you do not understand, but you will know after this." Peter didn't get it. They didn't understand. Do we? Do we understand why Jesus came? Peter says, "No, you will not wash my feet." And I want you to notice this in the story. Peter has been pricked in the heart, hasn't he? He feels terrible for the fact that Jesus has got up to do this. And so he's off. He feels awful, and he's got the rebuke. But I want you to notice what Peter does not say. Peter doesn't say to him, "Lord, I get it. I'm sorry. Let me wash everybody's feet." Doesn't say that, does he? He's still focused on himself. In fact, in verse 9, when Jesus says, "I have to do this," he says, "Okay, well, then just wash all of me then." Still focused all on himself. Jesus had told them, "I have come to serve others," and he's trying to change their focus too. And now Jesus shows them with the foot washing, "I have come to serve." Follow with me in verse 12. "So when he had washed their feet and taken his garments, he sat down again and he said to them, 'Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am.'" In verse 14, "If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. But most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them." Jesus is trying to change their focus off of themselves, off of an earthly kingdom, and now Jesus shows them with the foot washing what he could never get across in a sermon. "I have come to serve." Why have you come today? Why do you go to work on Monday? Why will you go to school on Monday morning? Friends, if we know why Jesus came, that must affect why we have come. Amen? It's got to affect why we live. It has to affect how we live. I've had people ask me through the years, "Pastor, what's the hardest part about a sermon? I mean, you have to do a sermon sometimes every week. You got to do a sermon. What's the hardest part?" I'll tell you. I'm going to give you a little peek behind the curtain. Hardest part of the sermon, here it is. It's not the study. It's not the exegesis. It's not finding the illustrations to grab imagination. It's not writing the intro or the conclusion. It's not even the practicing of it on Friday. And the hardest part of the sermon is not even the preaching of it, though I know some pastors who barf every morning before they preach. Yeah. What's the hardest part of the sermon? I'm going to tell you right here, right now. The hardest part of the sermon is living it. That's the hardest part of the sermon. The hardest part of any sermon, living the message, because that's why we're here. That's why we breathe. Because the message of Christ he showed us is to serve others. There's a wonderful quote that says, Jesus' holy ambition was to make the world a better place after he had been there. And how did he do that? By serving others. That's why he came. Why have you come? Have you come to serve? For my friends, in our lives, without serving, we will prevent ourselves from becoming like Christ. And we'll miss out on that amazing blessing. But maybe this morning you're asking, but Pastor, how do I do that? How do I serve? Well, don't ask me. Ask God, right? Get on your knees and ask God, how can I serve you? And if you are brave enough to pray that prayer, I'm going to tell you what Jesus is going to say. How do you know? I know. When we ask God, how can I serve you? God will reply and he will say, you can't. I'm God. I don't need your service. But if you want to serve me, go and serve others. And once you hear that, then ask Jesus, how? How can I serve others? Ask him that. And then listen. And don't stop praying until God gives you your answer. Because your answer for service may look different from mine, and it may be different from the person sitting next to you. But God will answer that prayer. And if we do that, my friends, if we have the guts, if we have the holy boldness to pray that, God may just use us to change this world. Loving Lord Jesus, you were so desperate to teach those men long ago that you would come here to serve. And I think the years have passed, the millennia have come and gone, and you're still trying to teach your disciples that you have come to serve. Not just with the literal act of washing someone's foot, but the symbolic act of what that means to live a life of service, of touching others, and helping others to know we're not here to rule, we're not here to conquer, we are here to serve. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we celebrate the Lord's Supper today, and all are invited to partake, whether you're a member of our church or not, we believe in open communion. But before we do that, you have a chance to do what Jesus did in a literal way. Today we will do and take part in foot washing. But though this is just one act, it's a symbolic act of God's love and how we live all aspects of our lives. So we're going to dismiss for foot washing. Let me tell you where you can go. Ladies can go to our gathering place, which is across the foyer here on the main level. Gentlemen, if you'd like, you can go downstairs to our youth chapel. Families can go downstairs to the fellowship hall for foot washing. And if you need assistance with foot washing, you can go to this room behind the piano to my right, your left, and you can be assisted there. Of course, if you choose not to, that's certainly fine. It's not a prerequisite to do foot washing to celebrate communion with us. You're certainly welcome to wait here in the sanctuary to enjoy some beautiful music, to contemplate and to think about Jesus and his love. And then after a few moments, we will come back together and we will celebrate God's wonderful love and sacrifice and service to us then. Thank you all. You are dismissed. What an honor it is to celebrate God's love and his service to each of us and to our world. From 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." At this time, the elders and I will kneel for prayer. The congregation is invited to bow their heads as we pray for a blessing on the bread and the juice.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the ability that we have to commune with you. And thank you so much for, in this reminder, and for the memorial that you broke your body for us, that we could be saved by the stripes that you endured. It's just amazing when we think about it, Lord, that just that sacrifice could be the key to everlasting life, to everlasting happiness, and we thank you so much for it. And as you broke your body, Lord, let us be broken. Let us serve those around us, and that we can not be surprised when we see you coming, Lord. You did not keep us ignorant with what this meant. You did not keep the disciples ignorant, even though they didn't understand. But we are so thankful that you have told us the beginning, what has come before us, and what is coming very soon, Lord. We thank you for that sacrifice. In Jesus we pray, amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're so privileged to receive from your sacrifice a position that we can call on you, we can come to you, that we can be truly broken, but put back together, Lord, in a way to serve. We thank you for your blood, Lord, that has flowed to wash us as clean as the whitest snow that we've ever seen. And Lord, with that, we ask that you would empower us. Help us to continue in engaged with your Holy Spirit that you sent to take that message, take it to others, Lord, whether it be today or through the week. And so, Lord, we ask this blessing that we would remember it as we go. In your name we pray, amen.
From the Gospel of Matthew. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Amen. Then Jesus took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Amen. Such simple symbols to remind us of the greatest event that has ever happened or ever will happen in the history of the universe. It says, this is the one time in the Bible where it says that Jesus sang. After this, he went out to the Mount of Olives to begin the long journey of what he had symbolized here, dying for us. And he sang a hymn. I can't wait to get to heaven someday and to ask Jesus, "What did you sing that day?" But today we're going to sing because the world still needs to hear this story. The world still needs to be served and to see Christian love and Jesus' service. So I'd like to invite you to stand now. And when we leave today, you have an opportunity to serve. We're going to be picking up an offering at the end of our service, a love offering to help those who are hurting and needing some help. So we'll pick up that offering, the deacons will, at the end of the service. But I'd like to invite you to stand now and let's sing about our heart's desire. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my life, in all that I do. Let's sing. Almighty Father in heaven, Lord, you have heard our voices sing. May you also hear the cry of our heart to be more like you this day so that we can serve others and help others to know you. At this time, Lord, this communion service has come to an end. And now the real service, the service to the world begins. Bless us as we leave this place, that we might be your hands, your feet, and your voice. In Jesus' name we pray. And all those who want to serve others said, Amen. God bless each and every one of you. Have a wonderful week and a blessed Sabbath.